So, one of the first things I'd like to address is that my opponent recognizes the fact that third parties hardly have a chance to ever win. And the only thing that they give as backing to their claim is that although they can't win, they can influence the ideas of the winning party so that hopefully their ideas can be incorporated into the next, I guess, period of presidency. However, there's no evidence, there's nothing to support the fact that, well, actually, wait, let me backtrack, actually, because we just accepted the fact that third parties will never be able to win. So, is that okay? Is it okay to just accept the two-party system as it is and never allow for anyone else to become president of the United States? And I think it's kind of weird that everyone's just okay with that. The fact that other people don't have a fair chance at becoming president, because the whole idea of democracy is giving everybody a fair chance. And just because they can run and express their ideas, there's no guarantee that they're going to be incorporated. Obviously, the opposing side has ideals of their own, and they're probably looking to implement them just as much as anybody else. Let's see. Moving forward, my opposition also states that there's an issue with how can you have democracy with the possibility of the majority overpowering the minority. Except, I'd like to say that although there's checks and balances to control the majority, there's no checks and balances to control the power of the minority. You can think of it as a game of rock, paper, scissors, you know? And that's some of what part of our government's based off of. There's a legislative, judicial, and executive branch, and each one of those overpowers the other so that each maintains a check on each other. Except when there's only two groups, which is just the majority and the minority, it's just rock, beat, scissors, and nothing's there to beat rock. And I think there's a problem with that because there's nothing to trump the other from having power over the other. And it's not necessarily that the states are automatically favored that are smaller than others, but it's the fact that states that are more competitive and have, it's not very clear cut on who the presidential candidate's going to be. The candidates will tend to focus more on them rather than states where they're mostly Democratic or mostly Republican, because there's less incentive for candidates to go persuade them, rather than the states that are more competitive and they know that they can be the swing vote to win an election. Along with this, my opponent also went on to mention the fact that with the example of Nazi Germany and the mob mentality that Hitler used to gain his rule, although we like to say that that's what we base our constitution off of and that's what we're trying to prevent, it fails to do that because there's nothing to stop, on a state level, anybody winning the vote by mob mentality. Maybe nationwide you can stop it by the system we have currently, but there's nothing to say that you can't rally up everybody in a certain state over one specific ideal. Maybe everyone in the South wants something that promotes their industry, whether it's farming or whatever else. And you can just get the mob mentality back in that, and that will also get you electoral votes. Moving forward, my opponent said that a reason that we shouldn't change or abolish the current electoral college is that it's extremely difficult to change. And I think that's a horrible excuse to give for not trying to change something. It was hard to change slavery, it was hard to change segregation, but just because it was hard doesn't give an excuse to not try to change it. Maybe it failed once, maybe it failed twice, but that doesn't mean that you should just sit down and accept things as they are. Thank you.